Production and distribution of City Club Forums on IdeaStream is made possible by the generous support of PNC and the Raskin Family Fund, with additional funding from Cleveland State University, Robert Conrad, and the Payne Fund.
Good afternoon and welcome to the City Club of Cleveland. My name is Paul Harris and I am president of the City Club's Board of Directors, and I'm pleased to have your attention for today's address. I'm very pleased to introduce today's speaker, Armond Budish, Cuyahoga County Executive, who will present the 2016 State of the County Address. Mr. Budish is in his second year of service as the second executive of a county that spans 459.8 square miles, is comprised of 59 communities, and has a population of over 1.26 million. He has committed himself to improving the life of county residents and has declared jobs, jobs, jobs as his administration's top priorities. In pursuing those priorities, Mr. Budish is committed to think big, use technology, be bold, and take some responsible risk. By way of brief biographical background on our speaker, he earned his undergraduate degree from Swarthmore College and his law degree from New York University School of Law. He thereafter founded the law firm Budish, Solomon, Steiner, and Peck, and developed a national reputation for his work in consumer law, estate planning, and elder law. Now, I suspect that there aren't too many people here in our large Huntington Convention Center audience today who haven't read one of his books or newspaper columns or seen his Golden Opportunities television show. And Mr. Budish had already established himself as a distinguished public servant before assuming his current duties, having served four terms in the Ohio House of Representatives, including a term as Speaker of the House and two terms as Minority Leader. In his January 4, 2015 inaugural address, he identified four areas of focus in expanding economic growth in Cuyahoga County. They were strengthening existing assets, including the precious lakefront and investment in the convention center, supporting the entrepreneurial ecosystem, creating a stronger workforce development pipeline, and supporting the prison reentry community to become employed, thereby reducing recidivism. He also committed to govern the county using a metrics-oriented philosophy to determine targets and shape future goals. Today, Mr. Budish will expand on his administration's accomplishments as well as the challenges and opportunities that lie ahead. After his formal remarks and a few brief announcements, he will take questions during our traditional City Club question and answer period. Ladies and gentlemen, members and friends of the City Club of Cleveland, please welcome Cuyahoga County Executive Armond Budish for a second State of the County Address.
Good afternoon, everybody. It's a great honor for me to serve as your county executive. Even if no one really quite knows what the county does or what the county executive does, what we do has such an impact on all of our lives. Yet the question I get over and over is, what does the county do? And if you don't believe me, take a look at this video.
County government. What it does?
County, like.
I'm assuming they do stuff with, land permits.
Food services.
You should know this, you studied that in school.
I don't know.
County executive, I don't know. I don't know what they know.
County executive.
I would assume that they try to keep the counties safe.
And they probably regulate taxes, which who's gonna pay what for the year?
I have no idea what the county executive does.
Yeah, I don't really know much about the county executive.
Off the top of my head, I'm not sure.
The question, what does the county do? good question. Good question. Next time I see the county executive, I'm going to ask you.
The mayor was joking, I think. The truth is that over 5 years ago, we didn't even have a county executive or a county council. The charter that created this new form of government not only changed how we look, but why we exist. So let's start there. Many of you may feel that you have already a lot of government in your life. You got the federal government, the state, the city. So why have a county government? The answer, in a word, is prosperity. The county charter makes it clear that this new county government must promote economic well-being and prosperity throughout the county. How are we supposed to do that? The charter answers that question too, through economic competitiveness, job creation, and economic growth. And one more thing the charter says, that your county government must promote the economic well-being and prosperity of the county and all of its residents. Not just some, all of its residents on a fair and equitable basis. The prosperity of the county must be shared among all of us. Now, how does the heightened focus on economic competitiveness and prosperity impact the county's longstanding commitment to the delivery of vital health and human services? Must county government now turn our backs on those in need? Absolutely not. In fact, it's just the opposite. The charter makes economic growth a fundamental government purpose precisely to ensure that we have the capacity to provide necessary and essential health and human services to those that are in need. There's an old parable about a village on a river. The townspeople see a person drowning in the river and they swim out to save him. The next day they see two people in the river and they save them. Each day, they must save more and more people floating in the river. Finally, one person, we'll call him the town's county executive, has this great idea to travel to the source of the river to find out why so many people are falling in. And he discovers a big hole in a bridge that's upstream. So the townspeople gather the resources and repair the bridge. That's what we must do as a county. We must save people who are drowning, but we must also repair the bridge to break the cycle of people falling into the river in the first place. Now, one note, my speech is going long already. If you applaud too much, it's going to go longer and longer. So that'll be the structure of my speech. First, I'll talk about repairing the bridge. That's going to be job creation, education, and workforce training. Then I'll talk about pulling people out of the river to keep them from drowning. That's our health and human services. And then we can all swim home. When I look into the future, I see our county as a place bursting at the seams with arts, music, sports, great food, festivals, waterfront recreation, unique neighborhoods, distinctive places, all converging in one vibrant, dynamic, diverse community. A place where businesses thrive, growing and profitable, with plenty of good jobs for our residents. A place where talented people come and stay to work and live. A place where our children start school ready to learn, graduate high school, graduate college, and build their careers, their businesses, and their lives right here. A place where all voices are respected and heard. A place that's inclusive, celebrates its diversity, and is welcoming to all. A place where we take care of each other. We protect each other when we are at our most vulnerable. We provide a hand up to each other when we most need it, and we promote equal access to justice for all of us. A place where our zip code at birth does not determine how far we will go in life. A place where the American dream is alive and well for all of us. So why does your county government exist? It's because we have the unique ability to bring together the partners, the leadership team, the resources, creativity, will, and passion to create a prosperous place for all of our residents. In order to achieve great things, you need more than just a bunch of good ideas. You need a strong team to make it happen. We led off by hiring a great leader and visionary, Sharon Sobel Jordan. And we have thoughtfully and strategically recruited a very talented leadership team, many of whom are here today. So I'd like them to please stand and let us thank you. We also have great leaders and partners within our county council, led by Council President Dan Brady and Vice President Pernell Jones. Will our council members please stand so we can thank you too for all you do. Thank you. And we have so many other great partners, including Mayor Jackson and City Council President Kevin Kelly, mayors and members of councils across the county, the Greater Cleveland Partnership in the business community, our great foundations, United Way and other nonprofits, our educational institutions, and so many more. And I have another great partner who's here today with me, my wife, Amy. She's the most important. Thank you, Amy. And as long as I'm at it, I don't have a big family here. My son Daniel's with us too. Thanks, Daniel. All together, we have a real opportunity to transform this county. So with my remaining time, I want to talk specifics with you. I want to highlight some of our top initiatives and collaborative efforts as we pave the path to prosperity. If we're going to foster prosperity for everyone, we must focus on job creation. In fact, when I ran for office, I specified my top three priorities, which Paul mentioned, jobs, jobs, and jobs, and those remain the same. In order to be successful, we're taking a multifaceted approach to job creation. First, we're taking a traditional approach to attract new companies and support the growth of resident companies. Companies like Dealer Tire, Lincoln Electric, King Nut, USA Insulation, Fabtech, the LaSalle Theater, and Heinen's. We know that placemaking is key to attracting and keeping people and businesses right here. So we've invested in community economic development projects like the Lakefront Project in Euclid, the Van Aken Project in Shaker Heights, and a mixed-use development at West 25th in Detroit. Our investments over the last year, which were made throughout the county, will result in the creation, attraction, and retention of almost 2,000 jobs. But we must move beyond the traditional approaches. To regain our prominent position as a leader in today's economy, I want us to adopt a new emphasis on innovation and entrepreneurship. We must foster a continuum of support for a culture of innovation, from helping to spark the initial idea to creating a successful business. A couple months ago, we partnered with the Cuyahoga County Library System to open the first Neighborhood Innovation Center at the Garfield Heights Public Library, where anyone can go to use a computer, a 3D printer, a laser cutter, a variety of other huge, wonderful, amazing machines. And you can get the expert advice you need from mentors there. This is the first place anyone can go for free to turn their creative business ideas into operational plans. Who knows, we may find the next Microsoft right here. I especially want to thank Sari Feldman, Executive Director of the Cuyahoga County Public Library System. Please take a look at this video.
Sometimes all it takes is having access to the right tools for someone to begin to build on their dream. Working with the Cuyahoga County Library System, the county helped put in place the first of a series of innovation centers.
And what we have in this innovation center is a 3D printer, a laser cutter, a professional grade stitching machine, and design software that is available for the public to use free of charge. It's really the county executive's vision to provide a continuum of service for area entrepreneurs, innovative, people who have that creative spirit and want to start a business. We can really make a difference in people's lives and a difference in our community.
This is equipment and software that most of us can't afford by ourselves, especially if you're middle to low income and you want to make a change in your life. This is a great place to be.
On a recent tour to the Innovation Center, County Executive and County Council members were able to test drive some of the equipment themselves.
See, even County Councilman David Greenspan likes using the new center. And look, he's creating his favorite 3D animals. In the coming months, we expect to open two more innovation centers at the county libraries in Mayfield Heights and Parma Snow. The Library Innovation Centers are the beginning of the entrepreneurial continuum, where anyone can get their ideas off the ground. They can then graduate to incubators and accelerators like Thinkbox, BioEnterprise, Magnet, or FlashStarts. But this good work is not enough. Did you know that Cleveland has one of the fastest growing populations of millennials in the country? We're attracting more MBAs and other people with graduate degrees than Chicago or even Seattle. Over the last 100 days, I've met with 100 of these emerging leaders. These young people, they want to stay here. They love the cost of living, the arts, culture, sports, and food options. And they see a great future here. But they also have concerns, concerns we can and should address. Many of them are entrepreneurs. They told me that a significant gap in our innovation continuum has been the lack of adequate funding for startups and early stage businesses. Without adequate local funds, entrepreneurs must look elsewhere and may end up moving their business out of the county to follow the money. We want their businesses here. To help fill this funding gap, we've partnered with Jumpstart, a local nonprofit organization that supports startups and scale-ups with both resources and mentoring. We've invested $4.5 million with the goal of leveraging our investment to attract additional outside funding. I'm pleased to announce that our investment has in fact leveraged the creation of three groundbreaking funds totaling $40 million to support startup and early stage companies right here. Please take a look at this video to see what early stage investments can do.
My name is Gordon Daly, president of Boxcast, and we aspire to be the best live video streaming company in the world. The story of Boxcast really was working a lot of hours after work because we had day jobs trying to build this grand vision, but not enough capital really to kind of get it started. That's where the county program came in, which brought us enough funding to help build the first products that let us prove that we could have a real business, and now we're up to about 18 people. We've even been able to pay the county back, and they still have a vested interest in the success of our company. So that little spark of $125,000 investment into us has grown into over $3.5 million investment from other business people privately funding us, bringing opportunity in terms of new jobs and new business for other suppliers in this whole county ecosystem.
One of these funds, the Focus Fund, is one of the largest funds in the United States focused on African American, Latino, and female entrepreneurs. This is particularly groundbreaking in light of the fact that nationally, of all the venture capital that's invested, only about 3% has gone to African American, Latino, and women entrepreneurs. Entrepreneurship does not just apply to biomedical and tech. If you want to open a boutique or a restaurant in the neighborhood, or if you want to expand your beauty salon or convenience store, our partnership with the Economic Community Development Institute can help. Last year, we invested in ECDI, which makes loans to small businesses that the banks generally won't or can't touch. We've helped 56 companies, 61% of which are women-owned, 45% are minority-owned. and our investment has already led to the creation of 128 new jobs. Please take a look at this.
I've always wanted to be a chef since age 7. Hi, I'm Brian Doyle, owner of So Food and Cafe Avalon, located in Warrensville Heights, Ohio, where our menu is focused on crepes and using local ingredients that just happens to all be gluten-free. Working with the ECDI was great. We got funded in August of 2015, and without that funding, we probably wouldn't have been able to open and employ 10 people that we are now employed, which is actually more than we had projected. And the business has been so good that we've actually had to hire even more staff. Without the ECDI and the county's help, I wouldn't have been able to realize this dream, making all this great food, supporting the local food shed, employing 10 people. I'm extremely excited about the possibilities of the future.
ECDI makes small loans, typically no more than about $100,000. But some small businesses need larger loans. So we're about to make another investment to leverage a $10 million fund, which will make those larger loans, adding to the entrepreneurial continuum. And keep in mind, small businesses create most of the jobs in this country. Our innovation continuum is designed to create and grow jobs and businesses, and that's crucial. But we also need to attract business to our region. Business attraction does not have to be complicated or costly. Let me give you two examples. Last year, during one of my 100 meetings in my first 100 days with business leaders, I talked about how our low office rental costs could be attractive to companies. Law, financial, accounting firms headquartered anywhere in the country could place their back office workers in Cleveland for a fraction of the cost of New York or Los Angeles or Chicago. Ernst & Young stepped forward, recognizing the benefits of locating new jobs in Cleveland, and they created 50 executive administration jobs here. We also want to encourage our existing businesses to bring their suppliers to Cleveland, as University Hospitals has done. UH insisted that a major medical supplier open a significant presence in Cleveland, and they did, bringing 35 jobs with them. I've asked our Economic Development Department to encourage more businesses to follow suit. The county has also made 3 huge, highly visible investments in business attraction over the last several years: in the Global Center for Health, the Huntington Convention Center, and the Hilton Convention Hotel. We're in the process of transforming the Global Center into an exciting hub for healthcare innovation, and we're already beginning to see great results. In recent months, we've added a dozen new partners and collaborators, including Dell, Cerner, Cisco, and Siemens. And in fact, Siemens Healthcare has moved its U.S. Central Zone headquarters from Pittsburgh. This means about 200 new high-paying jobs to the Global Center. This shows the power of the Global Center to bring new health innovation companies to Cleveland. The Global Center is attracting programming that's innovative too, like the HIMSS Connectathon, which brings hundreds of engineers from around the world for a week to work collaboratively to enable products from competing companies to talk to one another. Please take a look at this.
The IHE Connectathon is a great example of companies coming together to collaborate on the future of healthcare technology.
There really is nothing like the Connectathon in terms of collaborative testing. You go down into the room there and there's 500 engineers from all different companies. You know, there really is nothing like this in the rest of the healthcare environment.
When I walked into the Innovation Center today, I was really impressed. It's a welcoming environment. It's an exciting environment.
Everything about it lends itself to bringing people in, having meetings, quickly becoming one of the best spaces to collaborate.
The Global Center can also be a magnet to attract the most exciting and innovative entrepreneurial new healthcare businesses to town. So I'm pleased to announce that the Global Center, with support from the Mount Sinai Foundation, will be sponsoring the Rising Star Awards, one of the largest new business plan competitions in the country, with the winners receiving not only a cash prize to support their startup business, but also space in the Global Center and mentorship from Global Center partners. There's real power in health innovators coming together in a terrific space. And here's another pretty remarkable fact. I've gone through 1/10 of my speech. Dan Moltrip just fell down. And I haven't even mentioned the Republican National Convention. 50,000 visitors, 15,000 members of the media, and one, Donald Trump. Without question, the eyes of the world will be on us. And if we show the world how great Northeast Ohio is, the economic development benefits can be tremendous for years to come. Without our investment in this Huntington Convention Center and the new Hilton Hotel, we would not have attracted this momentous event. And I'm proud to announce that the hotel will open both on time and under budget. Okay, so far I've talked about job creation, attraction, and growth. But creating prosperity for residents throughout the county, no matter where we start in life, clearly requires three more things. One, a high quality education. Two, access to training. And three, help removing the barriers that inevitably arise along life's journey, particularly for those of us left most in need by poverty, poor health, hunger, and despair. To break the cycle of poverty, we must start at the beginning, before a child even reaches kindergarten, in the first 2,000 days of life. We must make sure that every child, regardless of family income, has the opportunity to fulfill his or her potential by starting life with a high-quality pre-kindergarten education. The studies are clear. Children who attend high-quality pre-K at ages 3 and 4 are prepared for kindergarten. They read better in third grade, are more likely to graduate high school and go on to further education or training, and they do better throughout life, and they get better jobs. High-quality pre-K is transformative. Please take a look at this short video.
We had come from an unrated center to a center. We walked in the doors and we were completely introduced to what it meant to be a 5-star center. Was it a hard decision? It was for us financially. We knew we were going to be scraping the bucket to really trying to make things work. We're a young family. Without that scholarship position, our kid would not be exposed to the amount of the art integration that is here, the amount of care that is here, and the amount of nutrition that is delivered at this school. Within 1 month time, she was going into sentences. She was expressing herself. There was so much more influence that she was gathering from the entire classroom setting of that age range that it was a complete notice of blossoming within that time frame. She's amazed us in the progress that she has made.
Come see you, PK!
Come see you,
PK! I believe the time is now to make a big investment in our youngest citizens. And fortunately, our county council agrees. I want to thank them for working with me to add $10 million for high quality pre-K in our recent budget. You should understand this is truly a huge commitment, because it was done in addition to the more than $9 million a year that the county already devotes to pre-K, and because it was done while fixing a $68 million budget hole. And we're not doing this alone. This community has a long-standing tradition of private, philanthropic, and public funders coming together to make big changes. Today, I am very excited to announce that we have exceeded our goal to raise funds to match the county's contribution. From the private and philanthropic sector, we have raised matching funds of another $12 million. For a combined new fund total of $22 million. That will enable us to more than double the number of 3 and 4 year old children below 300% of poverty attending our high quality pre-K program, from 2,000 to over 4,000 children. And we will sustain those numbers through July 2020. I especially want to thank my good friend, Regional President of PNC Bank, Paul Clark. Paul took on the challenge to raise these funds for our young children. He's devoted countless hours to this tremendous effort. Thank you so much, Paul, for helping us change lives. I also want to thank, you can applaud for Paul again if you want, that's good. He put in a lot of time. I also want to thank the people and organizations listed on the screen for their generosity and understanding of the importance of giving all of our children the opportunity for a great start in life. Many of these leaders are here today, and I want all of us to thank them for their generosity. Starting with our youngest residents is the best way to break the devastating cycle of poverty and hopelessness. But we must still provide a hand up for those that have not come out of our education system, college, or career ready. This is where our workforce system is supposed to step in, and for many it does. Last year, programs funded and operated by the county's Department of Job and Family Services and the Cleveland Cuyahoga County Workforce Development Board resulted in 4,211 placements and 478 people trained. But here's the disconnect. We still have employers telling us that they have thousands of jobs open, yet they can't find qualified workers, and we have thousands of people who want to work and can't get jobs. While we have some great training programs, our workforce system is broken. Both business leaders and job seekers tell me that they have trouble navigating our community's complicated network of providers and programs in order to get what they need. We need a better coordinated workforce systems approach. And we need to start by changing our definition of success. Up until now, workforce success has been defined as helping someone get a job, any job, even a minimum wage job with no future, and even a job that they leave in 6 months. We all claim success and move on, but that's not success. In fact, I should amend my priorities from jobs, jobs, jobs to careers, careers, careers. Success is a real path out of poverty, off public benefits, and onto a career. We're starting by adding incentives to our contracts with providers to encourage them to place our residents in jobs that pay at least $12 an hour or more and are full-time. And we're also focused on turning our summer job program for 18 to 24-year-olds into an internship program, serving as the first step on the path to a career. So this summer, it's our intent to place 30% of our 1,000 placements into private sector jobs, a significant increase over prior years. And we're asking private sector businesses to join us in this partnership and to make job openings available. And for our new workforce system approach, we'll provide longer-term coaching and post-employment services that our residents need to access the education, training, and other resources to succeed. To help a person get not just that first job, but the second job, the third, the fourth, and on up on a career ladder until they reach a wage that they can sustain themselves and their families. There are no quick fixes, but we can and we will solve our workforce issues with a long-term systems solution. And when we talk about creating a path to a career, we must address hurdles that many people face, particularly minorities and women. We conducted a disparity study which confirmed what many have long known. Minorities and women are not sharing fairly in job opportunities. That must change. A couple of months ago, Councilman Purnell Jones, other members of council, and I introduced a robust package of legislative and executive initiatives which should help level the playing field. We will lower the barriers to entry for minority and women businesses and create more opportunities to get their foot in the door. We'll adopt preferences for companies that have proven track records for using a diverse workforce. And we will provide an inclusion officer to monitor and enforce these reforms. We must do all we can to enable women and minorities to succeed. And when we talk about workforce, too often one group is entirely forgotten. Those with a criminal record who are looking to re-enter society. As many of you know, one of the county's roles is to run the jail, and it can be discouraging. My directors and wardens see the same people coming in again and again because they have no path forward. People without education or training to get a job, and then they may commit a crime and go to jail. And when they come out, we expect that somehow, miraculously, they'll be able to get a job and become productive. It doesn't make sense. We need to make a change, to give those who want it a chance to make a change. To that end, we've established comprehensive re-entry services at the Euclid Jail. This new program is a collaborative with Edwin's Leadership and Restaurant Institute and Brandon Krastowski, chosen, by the way, as a 2016 National CNN Hero. And partnering as well with the Workforce Development Board, Towards Employment, Recovery Resources, Tri-C, and our Departments of Corrections and Job and Family Services. We are training inmates so they can pursue a career when they're released. Please take a look at this video.
What this facility is focused on is creating an environment of learning and hope and for people who want to move forward in a positive manner when they leave here. It helps them build resumes, helps them with interviews, helps give them the technical expertise in our culinary arts program.
Our goal here for the culinary program is to teach these guys the basic skills, as knife skills, soup stocks, sauces, meats, poultry, seafood. And hopefully these guys are going to take these skills outside of this jail and help themselves and their careers.
This program is really great because it's paired up with Tri-C and Edwin's Restaurant and Shaker, and we have an opportunity to learn the basics here and then go on and learn further.
Yeah, it's a great stepping stone. It helps you. You got your self-esteem up a little bit more. Oh yes, learn a lot, you know what I mean? To be more patient on when you're cooking and not to rush what you're cooking. You know, you get to taste your own food, so that's the best part about it.
I feel it's a groundbreaking program because the goal is to change folks' lives, have a better life for yourself, for your family, and be a productive citizen within the community.
Thank you. So far, I've been talking about our focus on economic growth and opportunity, repairing the bridge over the river, so people don't keep falling in and falling in. But we must also pull out of the river those that do fall in. We must continue to help those who are most vulnerable and most in need. So if a young child is abused or neglected, the county must step in to help. If your elderly parent is taken advantage of financially or is physically harmed, the county is there to protect them. We support food programs for those who are starving, shelter for those among us who are homeless, and needed services for those among us with special needs. The county is there for our neighbors, our friends, our family, for many of us when we have nowhere else to turn. Over the past year, we've reviewed and improved the way we deliver health and human services in order to achieve better results for the people that we serve. I'll mention just three wonderful accomplishments. Let's start with our children. Sadly, there are times when a child must be removed from the family setting, with custody going to the county, to protect a child from an unhealthy home environment. But the ultimate goal is to return that child to his or her home as soon as it is safe to do so. In 2015, we reunited 425 children with their parents or custodians, the most in several years. That is a very big deal. Please take a look at one touching story.
Hi, my name is Adrienne, and the county helped me reunite with my family. First of all, I got involved with the county through my grandparents. They saw that I had a problem. I couldn't see it. My family was just telling me I needed help. The county actually showed me where to get the help. I end up going to a treatment center for alcoholism. Eventually, after completing treatment and parenting classes and anger management classes, I ended up going back, finishing school, getting my GED. I eventually got a job. I eventually got housing, and eventually I got my children back. I'm still sober. I'm that mother today that I always wanted to be. Thank God for the county. Thank God for that social worker that told me I can do it. It's a beautiful feeling to have my children back. And I got myself back. I got myself back. So I want to thank the county for that.
Hard to follow that. Second, we support more than 20 senior centers around the county. These centers provide an important setting for social programs and meals, enabling more of our older residents to age in the community. And in 2015, we actually stepped in to save four centers from closing their doors. Recognizing the increasing need for senior services in our communities, we've launched a series of innovation grants under which communities will come together to propose new approaches, innovative approaches, to more effectively and efficiently provide services for seniors. Third, we must end the shamefully high rate of infant mortality in our county. We have the best health care in the world right outside our doors. Yet we have one of the worst rates of infant mortality. We should be mortified. But more importantly, we should take action, and I'm proud to say that we are. For the first time, the county is taking a leadership role, along with the City of Cleveland and Council President Kevin Kelly, who's here today. Together with the hospitals, foundations, managed care, and business community in a shared effort that we're calling First Year Cleveland, we're devoting significant resources and focusing our efforts collaboratively to attack this terrible problem. A child's zip code should no longer dictate whether he or she lives to see a first birthday. There's so much more that I haven't even touched on, but Dan Moulthrop is having a heart attack right now. So I will leave you with this. I envision a county where everyone has a real opportunity to prosper and to grow, and a county government that creates an environment where every person can succeed, no matter where that person starts in life. If you can't tell yet, I am very excited about our future here in Cuyahoga County. Our county is truly on the move. Together, we can all achieve a wonderful and bright future. Thank you very much.
It wouldn't be the City Club unless we allow questions and answers, so we're going to transition quickly to our Q&A period. We welcome questions from everyone. You can tweet at the City Club. To ask a question here in the room, please line up at one of the two mics we have set up here, and we're trying to get as many questions in as possible in our remaining time. First question, please.
Good afternoon. I'm very excited about the work that you're doing with preschool.
Thank you.
The research has shown that children who are born into poverty are usually sometimes in very unhealthy environments that has a very negative impact on the brain, making it harder for them to regulate their behavior, which results in many preschool children being suspended, especially African American boys. My question is, out of that $22 million you spoke of, will there be a percentage of that money devoted to very good trauma-informed professional development for the teachers who are going to be working with these young children?
Yes, thank you for the question. Thanks for all your work in education. The answer is absolutely yes. This new program, it's not new. It's something we've been doing, but it's a huge expansion. And we have support from places like the St. Luke's and the Mount Sinai Foundations for the very reason that we're supporting the wraparound services that go with providing a high-quality education. It's critically important. We're not talking about just classroom. To do well in your classroom, you have to have a well-trained teacher. You have to have an environment with nutrition and health care and all the other things that come together. That's what we do in our high-quality pre-K program that the county is expanding tremendously here. So the answer is yes. I'll try not to answer too long because I know I took too long in the speech, so get more questions in.
Could you tell me about your plans to work with Joe Simperman at Global Cleveland to attract more immigrants here and, most importantly, make them feel comfortable here?
Absolutely. It's very important, and I see Albert Ratner sitting here, who's been a longtime supporter of Global Cleveland. In fact, I was just at a meeting with Global Cleveland and thanking Beju Shaw for the work he's done and Joe Simperman for the work he's going to be doing. Global Cleveland is critically important. We need to be a welcoming place. We need to have to make sure that everybody feels good about coming to this county. And I believe we're doing that, and Global Cleveland plays a big role. We're a financial supporter of Global Cleveland. We're an active personal supporter of Global Cleveland, and we look forward to Joe Simperman taking the reins and really expanding what they do. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Mansfield Fraser, Neighborhood Solutions.
Yes, how Mansfield, good to see you.
Good seeing you, sir. We're urban farmers.
I know.
Yeah. Most of the emphasis is on high-tech industries. There's very little attention paid to urban farming, where there can be, and we have created real jobs, real paying jobs. We just entered into a relationship last year with Cuyahoga Hills Boys School with the state.
Wow.
We take their young men as soon as they get out and give them a job. We work them pretty hard also, but we want them to know they can get a job. We'd like to expand, but in fact, you know, we grow grapes, so some people are standoffish. Well, you're growing grapes. Somebody might drink your wine and get drunk, who knows? We also are getting ready to plant hops. There are so many vacant lots and vacant land around Cleveland. We know we can expand that for low-tech jobs. Now, the guys that don't like to get their hands dirty, I send them over to Brandon, let them work in a restaurant. But how can we get more interest in supporting urban farming simply because it's low tech?
Well, first of all, I want to thank you for what you're doing. My wife and I had a chance to go out and, as you know, see your urban farm. It's very exciting what you're doing there. And you represent what we're trying to do here as a county, and that is support and encourage entrepreneurship and innovation, and you're doing that. And Again, our support for the ECDI, for example, to help with loans to small businesses to grow, it might be something that could be helpful to you. You should definitely follow up with ECDI. Thanks, Mansfield.
Good afternoon, Mr. County Executive. Charles Patton here.
Yes.
I am on the board of Head Start here in Cleveland. And the section you did about what does the county exec do was interesting. And I'm just interested. We've been hearing about the lead paint problem in Michigan. And I've been reading that that same problem exists here. And I'm wondering if the county has any involvement. What can you do? Because it is the same thing. And it affects those young children in pre-K development. So hopefully you guys have discussed this and you can let us know what's going on. Thank you.
Thank you. The lead poisoning problem is a terrible problem, not just in Cleveland or Cuyahoga, but all over the country. Homes that were built years ago were built with paint that had lead in it. And it's those homes now, with some of the paint chips off, it becomes a horrible, horrible problem for our kids. The federal government took the lead in remediation, in providing funds, and the county administered those funds, but the problem is that the federal government has cut way back on the funding for those programs. So the remediation programs are not sufficient right now. We're engaging in discussions as we speak as to what we can do in collaboration with the city of Cleveland and with the health department and others. I can tell you that University Hospitals, for example, is very engaged in this and just had a conversation yesterday, I believe, about what we can do to address this problem. It's a serious problem, and there's no easy solution for it.
Hi, my name is Marissa Heaney from Baldwin-Wallace University. As a supporter of reentry programs, I'm wondering what you could anticipate or project the county's role in what I hope would be increasing action on the CQE legislation, since it's still relatively new.
I'm sorry, you have to tell me CQE.
The Certification for Qualified Employment.
Okay. You know, our efforts in reentry are critically important. As I said in my speech, the need to address, to make sure that we are preparing people who have been incarcerated to take on a career, to get involved in a job that leads to a career, so that we don't continue to pay money out on the other end in jails or in other treatment programs. We need to address the problem we need to repair the bridge. We need to fix the hole in the bridge, and that means making sure we're training people, hopefully, as we're doing in the new Euclid jail project, to make sure that when they come out, they have the ability to get a job. We're also working with employers to deal with the stigma that sometimes prevents people from getting hired even when they do have the skills necessary for the job. We've worked with, for example, one of the big placement firms that places people into trucking jobs where you don't need to worry about the stigma. They will hire people who, as long as it's not a violent criminal past, they will hire people, but we haven't yet connected well enough the fact that there are these opportunities out there with the fact that people need jobs. So we're working on all those different angles. We support any legislation that will help people with the reentry into society.
Good afternoon. My name is Kirsten Pamalas, and I'm here with the Youth Forum Council today with the City Club. I had a question on recidivism as well. So is the program at Euclid Jail specific to Euclid Jail, or does it exist at other local jails? And if it doesn't, do you plan on expanding it to other jails?
Well, the Euclid Jail is the location, but it's not limited to Euclid. This is now a county, part of the county jail system. So what we're doing is we move people when they're ready to go into this program from the from the downtown jail to the Euclid jail. So we'll be able to hopefully help a lot of people over the coming years, you know, moving people in and out as they get ready to leave the jail and reenter society.
Hi, good afternoon, County Executive Budish. Will Tarter from the Center for Community Solutions. One of the big successes from the past year was the passage of Issue 23, the Health and Human Service Levy. Mm-hmm. I was wondering if you could talk about the impact of those levy dollars on seniors, mental health, and what you envision the future of levy dollars and their importance to furthering the mission of the county.
Absolutely. So, unfortunately, when I wrote this speech, it was about, believe it or not, it was another half hour longer than what you heard. One of the things that got left on the cutting room floor was a discussion about the Health and Human Services levy. Sharon cut all those things out, by the way. What I had intended to say, and now I can, at least in the small part, is the fact that I am so grateful to the people of Cuyahoga County for their strong support of the Health and Human Services levy. And County Council, again, played such a significant role. Dale and Dan and others, Purnell, you know, went out and talked and raised money and did all the things that we need to make sure that this levy passed. This is critical. Everything that I talked about today, virtually, is paid for by the Health and Human Services levy, the reentry services, the workforce services, our senior services, as you mentioned. Everything we do that's so critically important is paid for by the Health and Human Services levy. It was overwhelmingly supported. We live in a great, great county here that would step forward. Everybody pays too much taxes, but when it's necessary, people step forward in this county and support the things we need. And I can't tell you how grateful I am to the people of this county for supporting that levy.
Well, today at the City Club of Cleveland, we have very much enjoyed the 2016 State of the County Address from Armond Budish. Today's address was sponsored by PNC and the Sisters of Charity Health System. Thank you very much for your support. Mr. Budish also appeared today as part of the annual Richard W. Pogue and Patricia R. Pogue Endowed Forum, made possible by a special gift from the Pogues. We very much appreciate their support. And we also want to give special thanks to our table sponsors, and you'll find a list of them in our printed program. That brings us officially to the end of today's forum. Thank you very much again, Mr. Budish. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for your participation. This forum is now adjourned.
For information on upcoming speakers or for podcasts of the City Club, go to cityclub.org.
Production and distribution of City Club Forums on IdeaStream is made possible by the generous support of PNC and the Raskin Family Fund, with additional funding from Cleveland State University, Robert Conrad, and the Payne Fund.